Hello everyone, this is Jeff from the Ozark Mountains in Missouri, USA. Today we're going to do something a little different, sort of a blast from my past. I suspect that most of us have had one of those moments in our lives that has kindled a lifelong interest. Well, what's in this box represents that for me. It was Christmas 1979, I was in the fourth grade, and I got one of these for Christmas. I'm typically not big on unboxing videos, but in this case, I'll make an exception and I'll attempt to share my joy in unboxing this with you all. It arrived more than 2 weeks ago, but I've been too busy to open it up and shoot a video, and the suspense is killing me. It's neither expensive nor fancy, but it brings back many fond memories from my childhood. One other interesting tidbit. When I sat down to do this video, I took some marker and marked through kind of some personal information I didn't want to share with the whole world. And I noticed this line down here, and I don't think you'll be able to see it on the video, but it says Department Urbana, which is rather odd because Urbana is the name of the town I was born in. Now, I am 99% sure this is not the unit from my childhood, but it's an interesting coincidence. So let's get started. That's nice. They included a page with the listing in there. This cost a whopping $10 and just about as much for shipping and handling. It came from a charity shop or thrift store, if you will. Nicely wrapped in plastic. And here it is. So, as you've seen, this is a Radio Shack 151 electronics project kit. It still has the original sticker on it here, I see, that says HHLT-2995, which I guess was a pretty good amount of money in 1979. Go ahead and open up this bag. And right here on the bottom corner, it says Japan. All the best stuff is made in Japan. So it's quite a colorful box all the way around. Get you a good close-up there of it. Now, they made two different project kits in this time frame. There was a 75-in-1 and a 150-in-1. And I can't remember for the life of me which one I had. This 150-in-1 is a little fancier. It has an LED display. What else on here is different? I don't remember. I remember mine had the resistors and capacitors and transistors and diodes. You know, a pot, a transformer, a meter, a relay. The inductor down here for making a radio and some batteries, but I don't remember it having an integrated circuit or the LED, but it might have, and I'm just not remembering that. I do know it had a CDSL and a solar cell because I can remember making projects with those in there. And it had your project book. Radio Shack always had great manuals for their projects. Lots of different things that you can build. The page is coming out there, so we'll go on here. They show you where the wires go, show you a schematic circuit, explain what's going on, give you a place to take notes. It's very, very neat. I thought maybe this would say who this originally belonged to in here, but it does not. And there's no notes. There's another thing it came with, the Morse code key. Mine had this. As I recall, it wasn't that great of a Morse code key. It came with loads of hookup wires. This is something somebody else has added. It's some other type of coil. It's part number 40-1089, so I guess maybe that came from Radio Shack as well. Oh goodness, let's get all these wires off here. I'm experiencing technical difficulties. Yeah, maybe we can do that. Oh, that was a really bad thing to do, Jeffrey. Well, after that disaster, dumping the thing out and apart, I took some time with a slightly damp rag and carefully wiped over everything to get the surface dirt off and gave it a bit of an inspection, and I'll cut in some close-up video to show you what I saw. The biggest problem is with this 2AA battery holder here. It's had some batteries left in it and they've corroded, and the contacts are corroded through enough they're rather weak. I found this 3 battery holder in my junk box, and I'm hoping I can take the terminals from this and modify them to replace the ones in here. We'll see how that goes. The springs are also just slightly corroded, so I'm going to take some deoxit on a Q-tip and just go over the inside and outside of each spring to clean them up a little bit. There was also a few extra earphones. These are not originally from this, that are rather dilapidated, so I don't think I'll be keeping those. I think the first thing we'll do here, repair-wise, is go ahead and take this back out. We'll prop it up over the box like that. And several of these wires from the inductor have broken off over the years. They're rather fine. So I'll tin up the ends of them and scrape them a little bit to clean off any dirt, tin up the ends of them, and slip them back under the springs. Okay. Use my little jar of paste flux here. And dip each one of them in there. So, well, there's a couple of these. I don't remember where they go, so I'm going to have to go back and review my initial video. Should have taken some better notes there. These are an enameled wire, which they stripped off some of the insulation way back when. I clean that up a little bit carefully with the knife blade. I'm just tinning it with some solder to make sure we get a nice connection. Now I'm going to get my jar of deoxit out, and then we'll kind of clean up the back side of these springs where we can get to them here, and then do the front side, and then slip these wires back under there. Well, the jar of deoxit I have is in a spray can like this, which isn't ideal for this situation, so I sprayed some in an old spray paint pan cap, or spray paint can top. Wow, that was hard to say. It turns out the only deoxit I have on hand is a spray can, which isn't ideal for this purpose. So I sprayed some in an old plastic cap, and I have a Q-tip, and I'll use that. Okay. Now, get the original wire out of there. I'm going to review my close-up footage I took. Okay, it went red and then green. That's why it is always nice to take pictures and make yourself notes. The leads just slip into the spring coils and you hook your project wires up on the other side into the springs. And that works okay. It was simple and easy for a kid to do. Not real expensive. Only thing I'm afraid of is that maybe where the wire and the spring connect, that over the years that has corroded. So, to see how it works. So, we've got those repaired. And we still have to worry about these battery contacts. So, the battery's kind of screwed in there, the battery connection rather, and it's got a couple leads that come through here. So, set that up like that. Oh, goodness gracious. Yeah, broke one of the wood wires. But we can always solder more wire. Now we'll hold that nut in place. Take our screwdriver. Get that screw out. Pull our wires through the cardboard. Set this part to the side and just have a look at the battery holder here. Why don't I get you zoomed in on this so you don't have to look at the side of my head all the time. Okay, that's a little better. So we have our AA battery holder here that the contacts are quite corroded on. And down at this side is just one that shorts out where they cross, but it is in really bad shape. I'll put a close-up in here for you. I'll cut that into the side. I think if I take a screwdriver here, just kind of scrape the rest of the crud out of the crevices. Destroy this battery holder because I have a lot of them left from an old project. Let that back out there a little bit. Well, this is wider than the original. I don't know if you can see that there. So I think I'll have to try to trim it down just a little bit. Maybe these pokey pieces off the edge. These are usually made out of tin-plated copper, so they're not too difficult to... Okay, let's see how that fits. Okay, my first attempt there didn't work, so I cut off the tab part of this guy from this battery holder. And I soldered it on, just get down here where you can see it, I soldered it on where the one broke off, so that's kind of cheesy, but for now it'll work till I can find a similar battery holder. And on the other side here, get this turned around where you can see it, maybe like that, yeah. This isn't too bad this contact here was a little corroded, so I scraped it and cleaned it as much as I could, put some flux on it, and I'm just going to coat that with some solder very quickly. Okay, that should be good. Now I broke off one of the little solid wires on this guy, so we'll have to make that longer. And some side cutters. Now this long wire is the one I just put on there. So what I'm going to do is trim that a little shorter. And if I get here to where you can see things. I'll grab these and pop them back into the springs. Backed out here. Okay, a couple other things we'll do while we got this apart is I want to drip some deoxit down in the switch here to clean it up and do the same thing with the pot. So I'll get a fresh Q-tip and try to soak up a bunch of this deoxit from that plastic cap I put it in. Mush it down in there. Do it that way rather than spraying it in there because I don't want to get it all over the cardboard. That's good. Okay. Now we'll do the pot. Enough from the cotton bud to run down in there. Run that wiper back and forth several times. I think the other thing you could do in a case like this is pick some up with a straw and just drip down on it. Okay. That looks pretty good. I'm going to put a little more these two springs that were looking really nasty. Okay, so now it should be functional, I think. We haven't tested all the components yet. I think what I'll do first is go ahead and deoxid all these springs on the top side. Be very careful not to get it everywhere. And then we'll try testing the components to see how they fared over the last 40 years. Okay, I'm not sure how well you're going to be able to see the meter here, but I have it on the ohm scale. And I'm going to test the resistors and make sure they're still what they should be. I'll go first here on the pot from end to end. Kind of flaky. There we go. I'm just going to wiggle the springs to make sure we get a good connection. Okay. So hopefully that deoxid will work into those springs. And now we'll go and clip on each resistor. This is supposed to be... Okie doke. I used my multimeter to check all the resistors, the switches, diodes, the LED, things like that. Everything I could check on the resistance and diode check function. And all that checked out fine. I'm going to use my component tester here now to test the transistors. I've already done a couple of them. Got it hooked up to the third one. And it says that's an NPN transistor, which is correct. So that one's working good. Now I'll check the capacitors. Imagine the capacitors are fine. As I can recall, when I was a kid, the only thing I really blew up was transistors. This is supposed to be about a 470 microfarad cap. It says it's a capacitor that is 594. So, yeah. So, imagine these are all going to be okay. I also checked the CDS cell, and the solar cell, and they both work. The lamp, you can't see that. The lamp here, which is up in this corner, was the base was a little corroded, but I cleaned that up. And I'll check the rest of these electrolytics here, and I think everything is okay. So then we can try building something out of the book. But since we went ahead and got this thing cleaned up, we should go ahead and build a circuit and see how it actually worked back in the day. I originally tried to do number one here, let me show you, which is the electronic candle, but I found out that the CDS cell on this is woefully out of range. CDS cell should normally be about 10K in the light and a few hundred K in the dark, and this is about 300 ohms in the light and 10K in the dark. So it wouldn't work. So then I picked out the machine gun pulse oscillator, which is number four, and I'll put a scan of this and pop it up on the screen, and I'll show you how. This would have been built. Well, it's nice that it gave us a all the terminals on here, the springs, are numbered, and it gives you a wiring sequence which says, for example, terminal 21 to 23, and then 22 to 24. So you just bend the spring over and poke your wires in there, and then we go 18 to 64. But I picked out these wires, you know, they're old, almost 4 years old. So I trimmed some off the ends, dipped them in solder paste, and retinned them. So 18 to 64 and 64 to 68. That's another rather short one. Some of these springs are a little corroded, so I'm just trying to find a relatively clean spot to use. To our key switch, and the other side of the key switch goes to 121, which is the negative of the battery. So basically, this is just a simple oscillator that sends a slow pulse through the audio transformer to the speaker, and it uses the key as a switch here. So if we press the button, so you're saying, well, that's not that impressive, but you know, remember, this was aimed at kids. I was 10 years old. 11 years old when I got this. I was 11 years old. And it gives a really great explanation of how the circuit works here and gives you some ideas for experimenting yourself. It kind of bothered me after 40 years that the first project I tried, which is number one in the book, didn't work. What it is a light-triggered flashlight, or they called it an electric candle. And it uses the CDS cell here and a transistor to trigger a relay, turn on the lamp, making use of the 9-volt battery to power the sensing and relay side of the circuit, and a 3-volt battery pack here to power the lamp. So even though my fix on the 3-volt battery pack didn't quite work right, it works good enough for this. And what happens if you adjust the pot here till the lamp comes on? It's about 2 on the dial there now, and it makes no difference if I cover the CDS cell up, and if I turn this back till the light goes out, it makes no difference if I cover the CDS cell up. Since the pot was 50K, I wanted to measure the resistance on the CDS cell to see what the difference was between the light and the dark. You'll notice that when exposed to light, we have between 300 and 400 ohms, which is 0.3 to 0.4 K ohms. Now I'm going to cover it with my finger, and that goes up between 2.5 and 3 K. Now, in my previous experience with CDS cells, they normally go from a few K or tens of K when exposed to light to a few hundred K or a few meg when in dark. Or, you know, depending on the chemistry of the cell, they might do the opposite. So this seemed kind of low to me. Then I looked in the back of the project book, and there was a parts list. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to find a good reference for any of the part numbers listed, which, you know, were from back in the 70s, so that's not surprising. So after scrounging in my junk bin, I found this CDS cell, which is probably of similar vintage, but I was able to find a data sheet for it and confirm, measuring on the ohm meter, that in the light it's somewhere around 1K, and in the dark anywhere from a few hundred K to a few meg, which I was guessing was a little better. And so we'll hook this up in our circuit now and see if that works any differently. Okay, now we've got the new CDS cell in circuit there. It had the leads cut really short, so I had to solder some component legs on there, and with a little heat shrink tubing to make it long enough to use. And I'm just using this mini grabber clip right here as a clamp to hold the wired to the component. But as you can see now, up here a light is on, and when I cover the CDS cell, it goes out. You have much greater range of control. Now you can set the pot where it won't go out at all, or where it works pretty good, or to where it won't come on at all. So, then the problem I had is that the lead spacing on this new CDS cell is wider than the original. I didn't want to modify the cardboard here in case I can find one that looks closer to this one. So I'm going to use this plastic washer, which I fashioned out of a PVC pipe strap. And I'll take this like so, put through the plastic washer, and with the leads bent in a little bit like this, by the time they get out of this plastic washer, they'll be small enough to go through the hole there, and we'll hook it up on the bottom side to the springs. So we'll go ahead and do that now. We'll take that original CDS cell out of there. Right here is where the CDS cell comes through the cardboard on the back, and the leads are just stuck directly into the bottom part of the springs. So I'll try to pop this out of there, and we'll slip that CDS cell in, and then our new CDS cell with that fancy plastic spacer on there. take the little teeny tiny pliers, pull on the spring with my left hand there, and with my right hand I'll grab that lead and snake it out of there. Okay, that wasn't too awful, and I imagine you got the idea. So try the same thing on this side. Stretch the spring out. Now, there we go. Now that one is falling right out of there. Pull it through the hole. Push the new one through there. Lay the leads out a bit. Okay. Gonna get that back down there in place like it was before. Now you notice the leads are really close here, but they've got that heat shrink tubing on there. So it'll be okay for this application. This wouldn't be something really great to do in some mission critical application. You know, for a 40-year-old Radio Shack project kit, I think we're probably safe. Poke that one through the spring. Switch hands here so I'm not blocking the shot again. And then we'll poke that in through the spring like that. Okay, now we will set that back down in there and adjust our fancy plastic spacer so it looks better. Hook up our lead again. We'll get you zoomed out so you can see. We will install the batteries again. Oh, I heard the relay kick in there. Yep, 3-volt supply going. Okay. So, we've got our CDS cell transplanted, and everything is working. So, yeah, I guess after 40 years, having the only component that seems to have failed being a CDS cell is pretty good. I'll accept that. And, of course, you know, the fact that AA batteries got left in the battery holder and corroded, that is an operator error problem. I'm not too sure about the solar cell here. It really looks oxidized on the top. I don't think I'm going to be able to clean that up, so I'll have to try some experiments that use it and see how that goes. It's funny, when I saw this kit online, I was sure it was the same type I had when I was a kid. When I got it, and actually it was holding it physically in my hands, I could think of, you know, projects I built and the things I had learned. And I learned how transistors work and how capacitors work and how SCRs work. And I said, hey, this doesn't have an SCR. So I found the 1979 Radio Shack catalog online, and we'll look at that here in a minute on the screen. And the link is below in the description. And anyhow, I found the catalog online, and sure enough, there were two different project kits. There was also a 75-in-1, which did have an SCR. And I could also remember things like drilling extra holes in the blank places in the cardboard and putting in some extra springs that I'd gotten a hold of and wiring in my own components, which I seem to recall kind of annoyed my dad. The hands-on experience, that tactile sensation you get when actually making something and touching it and wiring things up and drilling holes and using tools, that learning experience is completely different than what you get when you're reading a book or you're watching a video, for instance. And it's something that, you know, kids need the opportunity to get their hands on things and to do things and to learn by doing and learn by making mistakes and then learn the troubleshooting skills to fix those things that they didn't do quite right the first time. So you learn just as much from that as anything else. My day job, I work at a university, an engineering school, and I get to meet a lot of really smart kids from all over the world, and most of them have never had the experience in their life or the opportunity to make something with their own hands, to learn how to use tools and to wire things up and to let the magic smoke out of a component and then learn from figuring out what went wrong. And that puts them at a disadvantage because it makes it harder to take all that theory that you learn in books and apply it to something you're trying to design. Back in 1979, when I was a kid, I was lucky that somebody helped my parents buy that 75-in-1 project kit for me. Now, I didn't realize it at the time that somebody had done that, but it was awfully nice of them. And it really set the course for my whole life. I discovered that I loved learning about electrical things and electronics and wiring things up and seeing what happened. My mom used to say that never to be too proud to accept help when you really needed it, as long as you offered other people help when you could. And I guess back then somebody's able to offer our family a little help, and I benefited greatly from that. You know, and I try to do what I can to encourage, you know, other young people to get their hands on stuff and use tools and make things and make mistakes and learn from that experience. And I would encourage you to, you know, do what you're able to. If you know a young person that would love to build something, even if you have to do so anonymously, you know, help them out anonymously, you know, and or maybe you can be a mentor. You know, you can help teach them things. That's how we all learn. We learn from people that know, that encourage us. So, nearly 40 years ago, something like this changed my life. It let me discover a passion. And, you know, I hope that most of us now middle-aged people that grew up in the kind of the golden age of computers and things like that can help out the younger generations coming along and help them discover that passion of building things for themselves, not just playing video games and, you know, using computers, but learn how computers work and learn how to make computers. You know, learn the joy of building something with your own two hands. So, encourage a young boy or young girl in your area. Help them out if you can. And, I look forward to seeing what they build. Oh, one more thing. Look down below the video here at the subscribe button. Click that guy and then click the bell-shaped icon right next to it. That way you'll know just as soon as I post another video. I would appreciate it. And the more subscriptions I get, the easier it is for people to find the channel. And I would like to share all these nerdy things that I find interesting with more people.